This is Charles Lloyd, and you're watching First Look.
Hello, I'm Don Was, president of Blue Note Records, and welcome to First Look. It's a very special thrill to speak with our guest today. For seven decades, Charles Lloyd has consistently elevated and expanded the parameters of music. At the age of 83, he's at the peak of his powers as an artist, composer, instrumentalist, and band leader.
All right.
And on a personal level, may I say, I've got more albums by Charles Lloyd in my collection than any other artist. And I think that's because there's something that I find really indescribable in his tone that's always affected me on a very deep level. His latest release is entitled Tone Poem, featuring his band Charles Lloyd and the Marvels. It's his 47th album and his sixth for Blue Note. He was named an NEA Jazz Master in 2016 and is one of the great explorers and visionaries of our time. Maestro, thank you for being here today. Good to see you.
It's a beautiful thing to be here with you.
Let's talk about the instrumentalist as a singer and a storyteller.
Well, I always wanted to be a singer when I was a little boy, but I didn't have the voice for it. But my heroes were Lady Day and Billy Eckstein and like that, you know. I didn't have that. And I kept pestering my parents. You know, I knew from about age 4 or 5, I was supposed to play the saxophone. But I thought in the day, hearing Lady Day sing those songs, I thought she was singing directly to me. I didn't understand that we were all in need of her love and sustenance. Mm-hmm. And so I got the saxophone finally at 9 from begging my mother from about 4 or 5 to get me a horn. I got one at 9 and I began to sing on it, you know? And so I still think of myself as that, you know? And Bill Frisell tells a story about the first time we met. He tells a story that I said to him, I'm looking forward to our singing together. And he said, wow, that's just what it is. Because see, Lester Young, he died, or he left town. That's what he says. He left town March 15th, the year I became 21 on that date. And so what was that, 59? And he left town. So I look upon it as Lester left me here. He said, the guy is an adult technically now, and let's see what he can do with the song. And I'm always moved by him because Prez was the greatest singer, and he also was a storyteller. And I remember towards the end, Buddy Collette, Master Collette, who was the spiritual father of Charles Mingus, Eric Dolphy, myself, James Newton, many others. He came to hear me play and he said, I love that you're telling these stories, you know? And he was like, I had stood on the shoulders of all the greats, you know? And it's a beautiful thing that this rich tradition that we come from, it's so pregnant with elixir. And these elixirs tell the truth about the whole thing and the aspirations and dreams. So I'm like, now when you mentioned the singers, I wanted to sing with Lady Day, but you know, I didn't get to New York in time. You know, the matriculation wasn't in the phase alignment was out of phase. However, and I wanted to marry her and give her the long winding driveway and the whole thing, but the Lord has a different plan. And Dorothy came, she heard my song, you know, and it's a beautiful thing when you find on the journey someone who can hear the song and know what it is and to join you.
Now, speaking of Dorothy, there's a great scene in the documentary she made about you with you and Ornette Coleman playing pool together. I love that. And of course, first single off the album is Ornette Coleman's composition, Ramblin'. And I know you guys were friends. Tell us something about Ornette.
What happened was that Ornette and I met at a jam session. I was in summer school at USC. I go up there with my horn. They wouldn't let me play. You know, I have to wait around. They don't know you. You know, if you don't know, somebody don't know you, go to jam session. You have to wait your turn, which hopefully will come, but many times it doesn't come. And I noticed that Ornette got up to play, kind of eccentrically dressed, had on some suspenders and different kind of outfit and stuff like that. And he had sartorial splendor of his own making. You understand? He didn't have anybody to tell him how to do it. And it was beautiful, you know? And so he played, but they invited him off the bandstand. And for example, if they were playing What Is This Thing Called Love, well, he was playing The Etymology of Love. Mm-hmm. And they couldn't handle that because you have to fit into the changes and stuff. And Ornette had long gone from the changes. You know, he was speaking about love, and then his sound was, so I got something from it, but they couldn't appreciate it. Finally, I got up at towards the end of the night and I played. Master Higgins was playing drums, if you can imagine that. Ooh, you get out of breath trying to play with Billy Higgins because you'd fall down trying to get some more air because he'd be so inspiring. And no matter how you played, a guy could play ahead of the beat, on the beat, behind me, Master Higgins would make you a tailor-made suit. That's how he was set up, you understand? So the thing is that Billy could go both ways. Ornette could, you know. And so I played, and then I came off. He said, yeah, well, you can play the saxophone, and that's great. He said, but that don't have a lot to do with music, you know. And he was an elder speaking tenderly to me as a young 18-year-old. He was 26, I think. And then we began to, like, walk over to each other's house. He didn't live so far. He was living in L.A. at the time. You know, he was from Texas. Mm-hmm. I'm from Memphis, and he was living over in Arlington. You know, we used to go to jam at his house all the time with Scott DeFaro and Charlie Hayden and Billy and Don Cherry and stuff. And, you know, we put together Nichols and his wife. What was his wife's name? Janie would go and get some American cheese and some oatmeal cookies. And so we would have a little snack in between, you know, playing. Then we'd go back at it, you know, for a couple more hours, you know. I like owe a debt of gratitude to him. And so I decided to sing a couple of his songs on the new recording. So I recorded Peace and I recorded his Ramblin'.
Yeah, let's play that. Let's play a little bit of Ramblin'. Charles Lloyd and the Marvels, Ramblin' from the new album, Tone Poem. Now, there's also a beautiful full band version of Monk's Mood on this record. Did you know Thelonious Monk?
I did know Monk. As a matter of fact, I was invited to be in Monk's band.
I didn't know that.
His manager, what was his name?
Harry Columbia.
Harry Columbia called me on the phone and said, wow, he said, I want you to go up to Monk's place. I'm early in New York. This is 60, 61. So I want you to go up to Monk's place. He said, because Monk wants you to play with him. I said, man, if Monk calls me, I'm there. Because I didn't know anything about intermediaries in those days. You know, managers called me, telling me to go up to Monk's place. Well, see, Monk's a deity. I'm scared. I'm not just going to go to Monk's house on some guy's recommendation that I don't really know. You know what I'm saying? Because Monk is high priest, you know? So I've lamented that all my life, man, because that would have been a finishing school and a half for me.
Let's listen to a bit of Monk's Mood. That was Monk's Mood from Charles Lloyd and the Marvels and the brand new album, Tone Poem. All right, so Tone Poem, it's such a beautiful piece. And I know it served as the source of your nickname for Joe Harley, who you dubbed the Tone Poet, which in turn inspired the name for our Tone Poet audiophile series that Joe produces. But let's talk about the concept of tone poetry.
When I was in college, we used to make these little kits out of, you buy this Heath kit, they were called, and the guys in the dorm could solder these things. You make an audiophile kind of sound. And then if you had bread, you could buy Marantz or Macintosh, you know, real high-end equipment. We didn't have bread like that in college, you know, so, but these Heath kits would get you. See, what you want to do, you want to hear the music live. This other stuff is like a photograph, unless you can get somebody or you can get some analog or some audiophile stuff. So I met Harley out here, and he told me, he came around selflessly, man, and offered himself, you know, at the lotus feet of what was coming through. And he just kept coming, and he'd find me equipment and stuff like that. And these manufacturers would bless me with equipment, and they'd say, oh, dear Charles Lloyd, Joe Harley's told us about you. And then when I go in the studio, I'd take him in there to oversee the sound, because here's my problem all my life. I could never get my tone. What I hear in my mind's ear wasn't coming through the speakers. Mm-hmm. Now, hearing it live is best, but if you can't hear it live, I want to get up inside of the speaker and I want to see what that is. And Harley brought these microphones, you know, these old RCA ribbon microphones, and he'd bring these Neumanns and stuff. And his ear is so refined that I started calling him Tone Poet, my Tone Poet, you know, and that's how that came to be.
Well, you know, the your new album, Tone Poem, is the first a new Blue Note release to be released as part of the Tone Poet series. Up until now, it's all been older catalog albums, but now this is the first new album to come out in that audio file.
That won't be an impediment, will it? Is that's a takeoff?
I think that's going to elevate the whole game, man.
Elevation, yeah. I'm into elevation.
Let's listen to a bit of Tone Poem right now from the brand new album. That was Tone Poem from the album Tone Poem, the new record from Charles Lloyd and the Marvels. Maestro, thank you so much for taking time with us today. New album,
thank you.
Beautiful.
And I thank the Tone Poet, Joe Harley, that I'm the first live one in this series, you know, because many of our heroes have passed on, but they left some sacred tablets behind. And I hope my tablets, while I'm still here, can touch people's hearts and souls and elevate. And freedom and wonder, that's what this music is. And that's what we want to be living.
All right, I hear that. All right, well, thank you, man. Really getting to know you and to work with you over the last decade has been one of the highlights of my life, man. And it's thank you for being here today.
Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.
Thank you, man. And thank you to everybody for watching. First Look, we'll see you next time.
Beautiful. Thank you, brother.
If you enjoyed First Look and would like to see more, please hit the subscribe button and also click the bell icon. That way, you'll be notified when we post our next video.